Hello, this is Tony Heller from realclimatescience.com, setting the record straight about climate. This is climate news for November 15, 2019. There's a huge amount of fake climate news out there, and I want to cover as much of it as I can. So I'm going to keep each story fairly brief and not go into as much detail as I normally do. National Geographic says that all the cold air in the south is caused by an overheated, melting Arctic. This comes after decades of predicting the demise of winter and winter sports. It isn't clear how the same air which is melting the Arctic is causing Texas to freeze. But 40 years ago, when it was very cold in the Deep South and it snowed in Miami, National Geographic blamed all the cold weather on global cooling instead of global warming. In today's article, National Geographic says a wavier jet stream brings cold Arctic air down south. That may be a counterintuitive result of climate change, some scientists say. And in 1977, the National Geographic Society blamed the same wavier jet stream on global cooling instead of on global warming. I can remember a time when I thought National Geographic was a serious magazine, but maybe I just liked the pictures of the island girls. Meanwhile, over in the UK, the global hunger strike starts on Monday to coincide with the beginning of the election rebellion. It symbolizes our collective vulnerability in the face of the climate crisis. But meanwhile, back in the real world, NASA is reporting that Earth is getting much greener due to human activity. Next story is that climate change is making children sick. But Oxford University's Our World in Data website shows that the number of child deaths has plummeted over the last 30 years since carbon dioxide went over 350 parts per million. Climate alarmists are saying that kids can't breathe because of climate change. But Oxford University reports that childhood deaths from lower respiratory infections have dropped by more than 50% over the last 30 years since carbon dioxide hit 350 parts per million. And then NBC News jumps into the ring. Floods in Venice, fires in Australia, and plague in China, all blamed on climate change. In yesterday's edition, I went over the floods in Venice and showed how the flood in 1825 was much worse than the current flood and that floods in Venice happen all the time. Meanwhile, the drought and fires in Australia are pretty easy to explain. This is the most recent NOAA sea surface temperature anomaly map for the whole world. You can see that Australia and most of the southern hemisphere has anomalously cold water, which is marked as blue. The waters around most of Australia are very cold. And look at all that cold water around the Great Barrier Reef. Not a lot of coral bleaching going on there right now. Cold sea surface temperatures means less evaporation, less precipitation, and more drought. If the oceans actually were warming, as climate alarmists claim, Australia would probably be getting a lot more rain. The worst bushfires in Australia occurred during the Little Ice Age on February 6, 1851. Black Thursday, probably one of the most terrible days of which there's any record in Australian annals, was Thursday, the 6th of February, 1851, commonly known as Black Thursday. We find it recorded that as early as 7 or 8 in the morning at Melbourne, the thermometer stood at 117 degrees in the shade. From early morning, the intense heat was accompanied by a hot wind, almost of the strength of a hurricane, and throughout the day, the surface of the country was exposed to the full power of its withering influence. Bushfires raged across hundreds of miles of country, sweeping along with almost the rapidity of lightning and destroying nearly instantaneously men, women, and children. Crops and homesteads, fences and gardens, and vast quantities of cattle, sheep, horses, pigs, and fowls. From the whole land arose a cry of utter desolation. Men who woke that morning thriving and prosperous farmers lay down at night without a farthing in the world or any resource left them but manual labor. About half of Victoria burned that day. Melbourne started the day at 117 degrees in the shade. CO2 levels were very low, and this was during the Little Ice Age. Blaming the droughts and fires in Australia on global warming simply isn't going to fly. And in China, a couple cases of plague were blamed on global warming. But during the Little Ice Age, plague killed most of the people in Europe. When I was growing up in New Mexico during the Ice Age scare of the 1970s, we had about 5 or 6 plague deaths every year. Plague has nothing to do with global warming or the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. It's a bacteria carried by insects on rodents. One thing which definitely does resemble the Little Ice Age is the deep level of superstition of climate alarmists. 16th century climate alarmists said that witches cooked up bad weather. Tens of thousands of witches were burned at the stake for the crime of weather cooking. But times have changed. Climate alarmists are more sophisticated now. They don't blame witches for bad weather. They blame Donald Trump, Republicans, and climate skeptics. And these very silly, superstitious people believe that they represent science. Visit Toto on the web at realclimatescience.com. He's been pulling back the curtain on junk science and propaganda for a long time. Hello, this is Tony Heller from realclimatescience.com, setting the record straight about climate. The Climate Central organization regularly engages in fraud, but they've really outdone themselves this time. They're predicting that 150 million people will lose their homes by the year 2050 due to sea level rise, and that nearly 500 million people will lose their homes to sea level rise by the year 2100. They are predicting that the entire region around Bangkok, Thailand will be underwater soon. According to new research conducted by Climate Central, by 2050, sea level rise could push the high tide line above the homes of 150 million people living on coastlines today. Rising sea levels could also push chronic floods higher than land currently home to 300 million people. That number could reach 480 million by 2100. These totals are significantly larger than previous estimates and have wide-ranging and profound implications for economic and political stability. Importantly, the greatest impact will be felt in Asia, where six nations, China, Bangladesh, India, Vietnam, Indonesia, and Thailand, are home to 75% of the 300 million people who will be living in chronic flood zones. These findings are based on Coastal Dem, a new digital elevation model that uses machine learning methods to correct for systematic errors in the principal elevation dataset previously used for international assessment of coastal flood risks, NASA's Shuttle Radar Topography mission. Wow, that sounds really sciencey. Who could argue with such sciencey sounding rhetoric? W.C. Fields said, "If you can't dazzle them with your brilliance, baffle them with your bull." Now let's look at what's really going on in Bangkok. This is Bangkok, and this is the region which Climate Central showed was going to drown. It's pretty flat around here, and the average elevation is about 5 meters, or 5,000 millimeters. The NOAA Tides and Currents website shows that there's two tide gauges in the Bangkok region. One shows very rapid sea level rise, and the other one shows very little. Let's look first at the one which shows very rapid sea level rise. There was almost no sea level rise there from 1940 until 1960. And then suddenly from 1960 to the year 2000, it started shooting up very rapidly. And at the bottom of the page, there's a note. This station has two different mean sea level trends due to apparent land subsidence. So there's something going wrong here. From the year 1960 until the year 2000, the land was subsiding very quickly. And here's another more complete graph NOAA has for the same tide gauge. This one shows that over the last 15 years, there's been almost no sea level rise at that location. There's obviously something very wrong going on here. Let's take a look at the station and maybe we'll see what's happening. And there's the tide gauge. It's built on fill dirt in a swamp. I guess no one should be too surprised that it sometimes is sinking. This tide gauge is a farce. Let's look at the other one. The other tide gauge shows almost no sea level rise since the year 1940, less than 1 millimeter per year. Remember what we said at the beginning, that Bangkok is about 5 meters above sea level, or 5,000 millimeters. That means it'll take more than 5,000 years for Bangkok to go underwater. Climate Central says it's going to happen in the year 2050, but it'll be closer to the year 8,000. These are some 5,000-year-old artifacts from Thailand. That's about how long it's going to be before Bangkok goes underwater. So Climate Central is predicting about 5 meters of sea level rise by the year 2050. Let's take a look at what it would take for that to happen. These are average winter and summer temperatures in Antarctica in degrees centigrade. The vast majority of Antarctica never gets above freezing. How is the ice going to melt there below freezing? Over the last 5 million years, Antarctica has cooled about 10 degrees centigrade. It's going to be pretty tough to melt all that ice. And pretty much the same story in Greenland. This is a compilation of surface mass balance graphs from the Danish Meteorological Institute. What this graph shows is the difference between the amount of snow which falls on Greenland every year and the amount which melts off the surface. During an average year, nearly 400 billion more tons of snow falls on Greenland than melts off the surface. In 2017, it was a lot higher than that. Greenland's surface gained 540 billion tons of snow. And in 2018, it was 500 billion tons. Last year was a little slower. Greenland only gained 160 billion tons of snow and ice. This doesn't really look much like a meltdown. Now let's look at what's going on at some of Greenland's more famous glaciers. Greenland's Helheim Glacier has grown about a mile since the year 2012. And the Petermann Glacier has grown even more than that over the last 7 years. If Greenland is melting down, it's not occurring very quickly. But that wasn't always the case. 80 years ago, all the glaciers in eastern Greenland were rapidly melting. Dr. Hans Ullmann was the leading authority on Greenland glaciers, and he said, "It may without exaggeration be said that these glaciers in Greenland, like those in Norway, face the possibility of a catastrophic collapse." 8 years later, in 1947, Dr. Ullmann warned that the Arctic had warmed up by 10 degrees Fahrenheit since the year 1900. He said at the present melting rate in the Arctic, oceanic surfaces would rise to catastrophic proportions, and people living in the lowlands along their shores would be inundated. "The Arctic change is so serious that I hope an international agency can speedily be formed to study the conditions on a global basis," he added. The only places you could get the water from to drown Bangkok would be from Greenland or Antarctica. But neither of them is melting very fast. That's why the tide gauge shows it's going to be at least 5,000 years before Bangkok goes underwater. Now let's look at what's really going on with this Climate Central report. They're predicting flooding in places like Bangladesh, which used to be called East Pakistan. A search for flooding East Pakistan in the Australian newspaper archives turns up at least 1,281 results. Here's one from 1970. Floods that have engulfed nearly one-third of East Pakistan's total area of 55,000 square miles have caused damage at $178 million. Here's another one from 1954, and at the bottom, another one from 1962. The Ebola cyclone in 1970 drowned 300,000 people in Bangladesh. The bottom line is that Climate Central isn't predicting anything meaningful at all. If they get a storm at Bangkok, which produces a 5-meter storm surge, it's going to flood. That's the way it's always been, and that's the way it always will be. But it doesn't have anything to do with climate change. They're simply predicting normal weather patterns in Asia. Trying to scare 500 million people with your junk science is pretty heinously bad behavior. But unfortunately, it has become the new normal among climate fraudsters. Visit Toto on the web at realclimatescience.com. He's been pulling back the curtain on junk science and propaganda for a long time.